good people don't smoke marijuana.
Well, I've known Larry for a long time.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana.
Ah, yeah, the medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 yeah, the medical. It's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Medical Marijuana Radio. This one is for Saturday, the 21st of July, 2018. I'm your host, Larry Love, and we're here every week to bring you the latest information on the use of medical cannabis and the fight for rec and medical, and this info comes from all over the globe. So that being said, we need to learn what happens in other countries and states. This week, our guest will be Gill Pollard from Canada, British Columbia, Vancouver there, and we're going to talk about her magazine, which is called Herb Life, which is H-E-R-B. Then apostrophe B. It's a magazine available printed and electronically for her. It's for the female cannabis enthusiast, and we'll be talking about that publication and, of course, what's happening in Canada. But we're also going to, this show is really based upon life after recreation. There was a town hall meeting at KOMO in Seattle that had all the experts that had been around the industry and the medical industry for years, and I took some clips from that, and we're going to listen to the problems that can happen with legalization of rec and what happens to the medical industry. So we'll be doing that as well, and then there's a story from Wisconsin about them fighting. So it's really about what happens with medical and how the programs sort of change after recreation. So let's just get started, okay? In Colorado, here's a report from inside one Colorado senator's hemp farm. Yeah, he's a senator fighting for cannabis, and he has his own hemp farm. Here's this report.
Well, Colorado State Senator Don Corum has a new hobby and quite the green thumb. He says he's passed several hemp bills in the past to make growing the plant for medicinal CBD oil possible. Now he's decided to grow it himself. He owns four different farms with nearly 50,000 hemp plants, and he says so many residents have told him about the miracles of CBD oil and what they can do for children with seizures and autism that he wanted to help grow the industry.
You know, right now, Colorado has 22,000 acres of hemp under permitted. So this has the possibility of really being a very, very good cash crop.
The hemp should grow to over 6 feet and be ready for harvest in the fall.
So obviously a lot of controversy going on, you know, with the hemp industry, with the bill that was passed by the federal bill, which is actually discriminatory against people who have been in the industry for years and have had some felonies. So I guess Victoria Carpio is going to be fighting for that, hopefully. I know that, I think the bill has either been signed, but there's a fight. We have to keep fighting. Also in Colorado, they have a new director of marijuana coordination, and she talks about her priorities in running the cannabis industry there.
Colorado has a new director of marijuana coordination. She's been on the job for about a week now, and we are the first local station to talk to her about her plans.
Radio News Channel 13's Colleen Sikora sat down with Dominique Mendiola at the state capitol to talk about her new job and what she sees as her most urgent priorities.
Mendiola has been working in marijuana policy for 4 years now, and in her new role, her priorities are addressing black market marijuana and collecting data to better understand the impact legalization has had.
Dominique Mendiola sitting down with us at the state capitol.
The industry is progressing very rapidly.
Her priorities for her time as director of marijuana coordination for Colorado, twofold. Her first, we've shown you extensively marijuana growing operations busted in El Paso, Teller, and Pueblo counties. Marijuana grown for the black market, hoping to offer even more help over and above the new plant count limit that went into effect January 1st.
We do see an opportunity to continue to work with local law enforcement, understand what additional challenges that they're facing, and ensure that we can identify ways to equip local law enforcement and work with them.
Mendiola also wanting to work on data collection to understand the impacts of legal marijuana on crime, health, safety, and more.
There, I think, is always a need for us to continue to expand on this data collection and understand, to allow us to understand what the impacts are, and particularly be able to understand the negative consequences so that we can allocate resources to mitigate those consequences.
For the director, data collection is crucial in the quickly expanding Colorado cannabis market, such as just what people are using.
Where are we seeing that any impacts in consumption?
Marijuana tax revenue growing every year since legalization, the first 6 months of 2018 generating more than half of all of 2017's revenue. But Mendiola says other states could affect that growth.
We also see other states coming online and legalizing marijuana, so that may also have an impact on Colorado and what we're seeing revenue-wise here.
It's an ever-changing and growing industry, and now that includes a new director at the helm.
Mendiola says the Colorado marijuana industry is rapidly growing and wants to work with stakeholders to address issues that may come up and protect public health and safety. In Denver, Colleen Sikora, KRDO News Channel 13.
So we'll have to see how this new head of the head coordinator of the marijuana, I guess she's the director. We'll have to watch her and make sure she doesn't pull anything. I'm sure there's plenty of people in Colorado that will be on her case. We're moving over to Wisconsin with a report from Fox 11 News. And this is what has to be done when states are trying to legalize for medical and or rec or both. You have to look at the pros and cons, and they're looking at other states. And that's why we're here today. We're going to be looking at other states and how it's affected. So if you're here in the state where I live, in New Mexico, and we're going to be fighting for legalization with a new governor, and the prospective governor on the Democratic side, which is in the lead, Michelle Lujan Grisham, has said that she needs to still investigate and look at other states and see what's going on. So this show today is about that. And here's this report from Wisconsin Fox 11 and how they're looking at legalizing.
Efforts to legalize medical and recreational marijuana in Wisconsin have been met with resistance from a Republican-led legislature. Some say Wisconsin's missing out on a huge cash cow. Mark Leland has been digging into the dollars and cents of the legalization. And tonight, Fox 11 investigates. Here's Mark with the real cost of legalizing marijuana.
Jay and Naren Seltofner would like to grow marijuana on their Green Lake farm. With marijuana illegal in Wisconsin, they've been working for years to change the law. As co-founders of the area's Normal chapter, Normal being the national organization for the reform of marijuana laws.
I think one of the major holdups is just lack of education or misconception.
Right now, the Seltofners are taking part in the state's pilot program to grow hemp. They're familiar with the plant since it has grown wild on their farm for decades. They are in the process of digging it up and transplanting it into an open plot for better cultivation.
We're going to grow it for CBD production. I'm hoping to develop my own CBD product line by next year.
CBD, or cannabinoid, is used in products that claim, among other things, to relieve pain and ease stress. Naren also plans to offer an edible hemp leaf salad mix. The hope is once hemp takes off, approval for marijuana will follow.
I think once we have plants in the ground and they see that it's processed just like any other agricultural crop, a lot of our legislators are going to look at marijuana and medical marijuana differently.
Medical marijuana is legal in 29 states, including neighboring Illinois, Minnesota, and Michigan. Marijuana grown for recreational use is legal in 9 states, with Michigan set to vote on it in November.
A statewide Marquette University poll taken 2 years ago found that most residents, 59% in fact, support the legalization of regulated marijuana. A Pew Research poll taken just earlier this year found similar results, with 61% in favor of legalizing marijuana.
Some Wisconsin lawmakers, including Democratic State Representative Amanda Stuck of Appleton, have been pushing to legalize marijuana for years.
Well, I think we're seeing a major change right now in how people look at marijuana, and there's definitely a push as we see other states legalizing and the benefits it's bringing in terms of income.
In states where marijuana is legal, the biggest benefits are the tax money it brings in and the jobs it creates. In Colorado, one of the first states to legalize marijuana, the state reports a $2.4 billion economic impact with 18,000 jobs created in the industry. Based on Colorado's success, the fiscal analysis of Wisconsin Assembly Bill 482 that Stuck co-sponsored last year indicates there's big money to gain. The Department of Revenue estimates legalizing recreational and medical marijuana would generate $140 million a year in tax and fee revenue. Cost to administer and manage revenue collection would be about 1% of that. Stuck points out the medical benefits of THC and marijuana have been shown to relieve pain, stop seizures, and ease stress, eliminating the need for many of those opioids that have flooded the market. And with marijuana legal, money could be saved by no longer having to prosecute and incarcerate individuals for many of the marijuana-related crimes.
One of the biggest arguments is just the amount of money we spend in our correction system on marijuana that we know as an overburdened system as it is.
Department of Corrections documents show at the start of 2017 there were 806 inmates behind bars for a marijuana-related offense as part of their overall sentence. Another 5,500 were on community supervision at a cost of more than $16 million a year. But critics point out legalizing marijuana can also cost a community in many ways. The nonprofit Police Foundation studied the impact of marijuana on public safety in Colorado. It details a wide range of problems associated with the legalization of marijuana. Among them, increased hospitalizations and homelessness, health concerns and building code violations from growing and using marijuana, and increased crime stemming in part from black market growers and distributors.
It's still a drug that still has impairment and still has some issues to the community because
Marinette Police Lieutenant Scott Reese helped his city council to pass an ordinance last December making marijuana illegal ahead of whatever the state eventually decides.
It's a cost to everybody in the community.
What do you say to those individuals who are opposed to it and they say it's going to harm society, that it's causing more problems, it's just adding to the opioid epidemic and the alcoholism?
I think the only people that really are taking that stand are people that are pure sobriety sort of people.
Like abstinence type people.
Norrin and Jay Siltofner continue to push legislators to see the positive aspects of what marijuana has to offer. The hemp cannabis plant has a rich history in their part of the state. That's why it can be found there growing like, well, a weed.
I look at it as like a gift. It's always been here, and now we're being able to use it and hopefully bring it back to life and, you know, educate the public and feed the public and maybe even help heal the public. And
for Fox 11 Investigates, I'm Mark Leland.
Okay, so that's what's happening in Wisconsin, and now we're going to move over to Washington State, where they've had legalization for, you know, years of medical. And these are experts that... These are experts that are critical about what's happened to the medical program and what's happening with legalization. But before we talk about that, here is a report about in Seattle, seniors are choosing cannabis over opioids for pain. Of course, we know this, but to hear people talk about it is great.
It's a deep muscle rub, and I use it on my right shoulder and my arm.
Connie Schick used to take the painkiller Percocet after her stroke.
Ruins your stomach for one thing, and it makes you addictive to them. And this is not addictive.
But now she uses a cannabis cream for chronic pain.
You know, you can feel the muscles just kind of relaxing.
Well, good morning, folks. Again, I'm Kelly Ogilvie. I'm the founder of a company called Deep Cell, and we work on technology in cannabis.
Kelly Ogilvie gives talks like these at assisted living campuses a lot because residents, like Connie, want to learn more about cannabis, specifically cannabidiol, CBD.
CBD is a non-psychoactive chemical in the plant, meaning if you take CBD, it doesn't get you psychoactively high.
Ogilvie explains how the Chinese discovered the healing properties of cannabis nearly 5,000 years ago, how healers in India used the plant for medicine 3,000 years ago, as did the Egyptians, who used it to treat inflammation and glaucoma.
You don't have to trust me. You can just literally ask my sister Sasha right here.
But Ogilvie need only look at his sister, Sasha, to know CBD can be a lifesaver. Her epilepsy caused seizures. She fell and dislocated her shoulder, hurt her knees. She got hooked on opioid painkillers for 6 years.
I had made a decision that I never wanted to take opioids again because it caused a lot of destruction in our family and for myself.
But when her brother suggested CBD sugar, she initially said no.
I don't want to go to a dispensary. I don't want to look like, you know, a pothead.
After trying CBD sugar, Sasha not only managed her pain, she cut her evening epilepsy dosage in half. She's been seizure-free since 2008.
I can't believe this works better than what the doctors had prescribed me.
Dr. Nefi Stella at the University of Washington School of Medicine has been studying cannabis for 25 years.
Can grandma overdose on cannabidiol?
No. Currently, there is no aspect of cannabidiol that we understand that would actually harm grandma or anybody else.
He says CBD has proven therapeutic qualities. He says researchers are very sure CBD can reduce seizures and help fight glioblastomas. And he says it's very likely CBD helps with pain, anxiety, PTSD, and some cancers.
Cannabinoids have a very good safety profile. It all depends on doses and how much you take and how often.
And so what companies like what we're doing is...
For Kelly Ogilvie, cannabidiol is medicine people are seeking and finding.
And the real beauty of it is that the cannabinoids are cheap. Relatively speaking, it's really affordable medicine for people. My sister is proof of the effect it can have, and so it's personal for me.
Lori Matsukawa, King 5 News.
Okay, so now we're going to move over, and we're going to stay in Washington, but we're going to go to Como, which is K-O-M-O. This whole town hall is available on YouTube, and I believe on their website as well. That's K-O-M-O. So, all right, so here we go. This is the first little segment I thought was interesting towards the beginning of it. Again, this is a town hall focusing on changes since legalization. And this panel sitting around are stakeholders, and if you want to know who they are, you know, go watch the video. But what they had to say I thought was very important.
Hey, Shelley, we mentioned that you focus on traffic safety. What have you seen in your line of work?
So in traffic safety, we've seen an increase in the number of drivers that are THC positive. So that's the psychoactive ingredient, not anything else that's going on in the numbers. From about 1 in 10 daytime drivers before retail stores opened to about 1 in 5. So a doubling of positive THC drivers. And in the fatal statistics, what we're really seeing is an increase in polydrug use. So that is a driver involved in a fatal crash who's positive for multiple substances, either alcohol and a drug or a couple of drugs. And the most common combination of that is alcohol and marijuana.
Right.
And we've done some surveys with people that use marijuana, drink, and drive. And what we see is there's a belief among some people that if they're drinking and they use marijuana, it kind of cancels it out.
It would make them a better driver?
Yeah. It reminds me of maybe in the 70s when you used to have a cup of coffee at the end of the party.
Mm-hmm.
Because you felt different. You might have been feeling sleepy and now you feel more awake.
Right.
With marijuana, you're going to feel different, but the impact to driving is still very pronounced,
right,
even at low levels of alcohol.
Okay, and we'll dive a little bit more into some of those concerns later as well. Right now, though, Vivian, I wanted to just ask you, in these years since marijuana has been legal, what have you seen change?
Well, I've seen our state take the moral high ground by ending the prosecution and arrest of otherwise law-abiding, nonviolent Washingtonians. And furthermore, we've seen a new industry, a nascent industry come up, both creating entry-level jobs to long-term investment opportunities. And to date, you know, raised several hundred million dollars in taxes. Some of that money can go towards some of the issues that were already spoken about, the important issues that, we're dealing with. And most importantly, we can start the process of fighting some of these myths that have been generated on both sides from prohibition all these years.
And you mentioned the money. Well, that's another topic that we will get deeper into, because the money raised, as you mentioned, the numbers are quite high. Farmer Tom, though, first I wanted to get over to you. What have you seen change in your area of business?
Well, we've seen a lot of small farmers go under. The corporatization of cannabis has really taken hold. We're seeing acquisitions and mergers within the Washington state market, where the small farmer has really been left out of the game. So we're seeing the same going across Oregon right now. All these counties are devastated. They used to rely on the medical marijuana money. Now it's been taken away, and that they've grown too much in Oregon. We've seen that in Washington also. And then California is going to be super devastated throughout the whole the triangle up there, the Golden Triangle, where they grow all the weed up there in Humboldt County and Trinity counties and all those places. Those communities are going to be devastated for years and years and years, because all the money from their communities came from cannabis. So all the new cars, houses, boats, all that stuff that was being bought with medical marijuana is now being taken over by a few big, huge operations that are, you know, monopolizing the market and really taken away from the small farmers. And we're the ones who kind of brought the show. You know, without us, advocates and small farmers and people who believed in cannabis and the well-being that it brings to everybody, it's really been detrimental to all these societies. And we're going to see really big problems with that in California. And I really feel sorry for all the farmers who thought they were going to get a chance to be in this industry, who are left behind.
So again, we need to be vigilant and learn by the history of what's been going on in these other states. Now here is what's going on with the medical in Washington.
This was Farmer Tom and Vivian, because people should know that when Washington legalized, it had 502, Initiative 502, it was the medical growers that opposed 502, the actual legalization of marijuana in Washington state. You're very familiar with the medical market. How has the medical market been in Washington state? Have all those farmers and the patients, are they just out of whack now? Are they being supplied properly?
No, they're not being supplied properly at all. The home grow issue is a big problem also, and the patients aren't able to take care of themselves like they were in the past. And with the patients network, we really need some patients networks out there. And the quality of cannabis that's being produced out here, you know, the lobbyists really push these things to downgrade the amount of pesticides that could be in the products and the amount of microtoxins and fecal matter that can be in the product, so they can move their product. And then we have the whole mold issue that plummet the thresholds on what's legal. And it's really been devastating to everybody, because it's legal to have moldy weed and cannabis. So,
what about the patients then? I mean, the patients have been relying on this product, their medicine, they call it, for forever, and now they have to rely on a recreational market legally to supply them what they need, which is a totally different product. Are medical patients suffering for the last 6 years?
I think the answer would be yes, Matt. You know, what we did is we took a situation where we had these kind of community-based medical dispensaries that already had a point-of-sale system, and they already had clientele, they had everything going on, and they had supply streams and everything, and we basically kicked them to the curb, recreated a new model, and the patients at the moment, you know, you can argue that they can go in and have access to cannabis, not particularly the strains, not particularly the CBD-rich oils that those patients need. And, you know, we've got patients here in Washington State with Dravet syndrome and epilepsy. Some of them, it's life-threatening, and they really, number one, need the access to the strains, but they also need the access to the medical quality cannabis, which we know has no pesticides or molds or fungicides and things like that.
Yeah, and I should let our audience know that there's a big difference between what's sold in Washington State in terms of recreational marijuana versus what was sold for years and years in the medical marijuana in terms of what the consistency. Not one weed is the same as the other, Molly.
Right. Vivian, do you see any movement towards fixing the problems that you're outlining?
Yes, certainly. I do see a lot of the access points that we have now, the recreational stores are doing their best to have CBD-rich products, and they have some medically trained staff, things like that. But, you know, I know several very, very sick people that moved to Oregon as soon as I-502 passed.
And now they go on to talk more about CBD and THC.
The potency of marijuana has increased at least threefold. And it makes me wonder if the products that are available in the rec stores are really the products that people who are validly going and using for medical reasons are the same products. You know, like my sense in going to the rec stores is that a high CBD, low THC product is, there's not very many of them. The supply is low.
Yes, the supplies definitely are, the manufacturers and suppliers are geared towards recreational, absolutely.
But even the potency of the marijuana having increased so much, I mean, I feel like the last time I was in a store, the lowest potency of bud or, you know, flower was right around 24%. And I'm not sure that everybody needs that. I'm not sure that anybody needs that level of potency.
Yeah, it might be larger than a therapeutic dose somebody's taken. It might be not as large as a cancer patient, for example,
right.
as well. So it does definitely vary. And you know, it's a brand new industry, and there's still a lot of growth and a lot of development to take place. And what we need to do is we need to get federal prohibition rescinded so this can be a nationwide industry and let the research and development happen and let the marketplace figure out some of these things as well.
But isn't that what happened in this marketplace? For 5 years, we've let the marketplace decide what is the hot seller, and it's high THC for people who want to get a little buzz going. That's kind of like what we all think about going into a marijuana shop, is getting something that will give you a good buzz, whereas the people use it for other purposes with a high CBD level, which is good for people who have some health issues. Right? No? Well, you want a combination of both.
Most of us in the cannabis culture believe in what's called the synergistic effect, the entourage effect of whole plant therapy. We're not real hot on isolating CBD personally. The people we know that have come back from deadly tumors and various illnesses have been using THC and CBD, for example. So we think that's overblown.
I know. Oh, you do. I think, aren't the growers growing to more the recreational guy who walks in with his friends and wants to get some weed to get really high versus ones that use it for a therapeutic purpose and
have it
for years?
The reason that people are growing CBD is because CBD has been partially legalized, and so they're trying to get around the law. But most of the people that I know that are doctors that work extensively with medical marijuana believe in whole plant therapy, that isolating it, like Marinol was a disaster, isolating just one cannabinoid when there's actually over 80 of them. And we think that there's an effect of all of them working together in a holistic nature is what's most therapeutic.
And they go on further about CBD right here.
Rye from psychoactive grade cannabis is illegal with this decision. However, the CBD from industrial hemp, tell us about that.
That's right. So the CBD industry is primarily, outside of the medical marijuana community, is primarily all hemp-derived CBD. So that's sold, you know, over-the-counter at Target and other just mainstream stores. There's a little gray to that whole thing, that whole industry, but it's completely separate and it's unaffected by this decision. This decision only talks about medical-grade cannabis. And cannabinoids like CBD and THC that are derived from medical cannabis, medical marijuana, not industrial hemp. Industrial hemp is a completely different animal. Those products will continue to remain unaffected by this decision.
So there's a conception out there that nothing's going to change until this actually hits the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court has to make a decision that actually confirms this. And from what I understand, that's a misconception. Yeah. So can you go ahead and clear that up?
I wish that were true, but it's actually the exact opposite. This is the law in the state of Arizona right now, and it's going to remain the law forever unless and until the Supreme Court reverses this decision and disagrees with it. The Supreme Court's under no obligation to even review the decision, so they may well choose, we're not going to hear it. They may affirm the decision. It doesn't matter, though, until that happens, until the Supreme Court disagrees with this decision, which is at least a year away, okay? Even if they accept review, it's going to be like a year before we get hear anything from them, probably. So you're talking about this is the law of the land, and it ain't going to change for at least a year now. And so it's not like everyone's just going to wait and see for a year. As far as law enforcement's concerned, you better believe that they're going to start arresting and charging people with possession of a narcotic drug who are patients and caregivers who are found to be in possession of the of any kind of a concentrate.
Okay, so that last clip was actually from Arizona. I had that mislabeled. I apologize. So, but it was very important to, you know, hear what how people are handling and thinking about what to do about the CBD thing. And we need to, you know, keep fighting for the use of this. As we know, the World Health Organization said there's no downside to CBD. So we're going to talk about herb lifestyle. That's H-E-R, and then quote... parentheses B. This is a magazine for the female cannabis enthusiast. And we'll be right back with Gill Pollard. Excuse me, I'm not Gill. Jill Pollard, right after this.
It's all about the 420 MMJ Radio. The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio Show.
Hi, this is Steve D'Angelo, and you are listening to Medical Marijuana Radio.
And we're back, and online today, from Canada, from Vancouver, Canada, I have Jill Pollard from Herb Life magazine. Now, Herb is spelled H-E-R parentheses B because this is all about her. Welcome to Medical Marijuana Radio.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So why are you publishing a magazine for women?
Well, really, because one of my favorite things to do is write about cannabis and write about women who, you know, live and work and have cannabis in their life all the time. And while websites are a lot of fun, we really kind of wanted something a little more tangible and something we could sink our teeth into. So we decided, because here in Canada, we're in the midst of this huge end of prohibition moment, we thought we should commemorate it with a print edition.
Absolutely. That makes a lot of sense to me. Going through your magazine, I see a lot of nice features. You have slow cannabis. What does that mean?
Oh, slow cannabis. So this was a story written by a journalist and farmer here in Canada named Kelly Coulter. And Kelly is all about organic, regenerative farming. So her story is all about sort of stepping back from big commercial grows and really getting your hands and feet back into the dirt.
So was with medical, which has been around for a long time in Canada, how is the medicine? Is there testing of it? What are the restrictions for dispensaries and growers?
Sure. So it's kind of a complicated issue. The first thing I'll say is that our current medical program here in Canada is really fabulous in terms of regulations and testing. So all of the licensed producers, medical cannabis that they produce, are subject to incredibly strict regulations. Everything is pharma quality. So they're, you know, grown in indoor rooms that are incredibly hygienic, you know, like clean as an operating room kind of thing. Packaged in same conditions. And then, of course, they're all subject to testing for, you know, pesticides, which are not allowed, you know, heavy metals, cannabinoid content. Really, what the government has done is set up Canada in such a way that we're going to be, or we are producing, the highest quality medical cannabis.
Right. And of course, you've been in the seed business for a long time. And I say you, I mean, you know, Canada and BC and so forth. Are there any restrictions with the upcoming adult use, which is rec, which is going to happen, I think, in October, you said? Are there any restrictions for people going into the cannabis industry there? Like, for instance, we have a hemp farm bill that was just passed the other day by Mitch McConnell, but it's discriminating against people who have felonies, cannabis and other drug felonies. They're prohibiting them from going into the business. And these are people that are experts that have been around for a long time. That would be like if, I'm not sure whether Mark Emery is prohibited from being in business or not, because he served a long time here, unfortunately. So are there any restrictions on who can get into the cannabis industry in Canada?
Well, actually, the great news with the new Cannabis Act that's coming into effect is that there aren't really any restrictions. So unless you have any known ties to organized crime or have been convicted of a violent offense, they say that you can apply just like everybody else. So in the case of Mark Emery, who, to the best of my knowledge, has never been convicted of anything violent and, as far as I know, is not a part of organized crime, should be able to apply just like anyone else.
Right. Well, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, some states here, I believe Washington and California at least, and I'm not sure about Oregon, they're actually expunging the records of people who've had cannabis felonies and so forth. So that's really a good thing, and I hope that that might go on over there as well, up in Canada. So do you think that... with the rollout of recreational in Canada, how will that affect the medical industry? Because for me, there are two separate industries with needs from people that are different.
Yeah, I agree. I think they're two separate industries as well. And as it is now, medical cannabis doesn't have like a drug identification number associated with it. So I would like to see that happen, that come into effect for medical cannabis, which would then make it a lot easier for Canadian insurance companies to insure the drug and help patients cut down on their costs, which can be astronomical if you're suffering from any sort of serious ailment. So for that reason, and because your quality is going to be quite similar for recreational, but it will be a little more lax. Like, for example, they'll allow outdoor grows for recreational. And with medical, they really want to keep it indoors and at that high pharma quality clean room standard.
Sure. So speaking of outdoor and indoor grows and patients and adult use, what's the growing at home grow situation? Are they allowing home grow?
Yes, they are. So every household gets four plants. Now, it does come down to the provinces to regulate. So some provinces are, like Quebec was sort of making noise about wanting to prohibit that. But I don't think they will now. And where I live here in BC, you can grow up to four plants, but it can't be visible from the street. So if you're like me and you like to grow huge, 8-foot bushes, you either need a lot of property or a very tall fence.
Right. Well, of course, I think everybody who's growing cannabis, and of course, I've been a licensed grower as a patient here in New Mexico for 9 years. So, you never want to have it visible by anybody from anywhere, or else, 7.5 months later, they're not going to be there. So, it's really important to have security when you're growing, especially, outdoors as well. Tell me...
people in apartments or condo situations, people who only have a balcony. So this
right.
is...
That's preventative for something like that. Yeah, that makes
sense.
Yeah,
exactly.
So how about, before we get back to the magazine, and we'll go back and forth, what are the prices in BC at the medical dispensaries right now? Because, of course, we don't know what's going to happen in October. What are the prices per gram and per ounce for good cannabis in BC?
Oh, sure. I believe the last data that I saw indicated that your average price per gram sits on the low end around $7 or $8 and high end around $11.
Okay.
So that's a sweet spot in there.
that makes sense. We're here in New Mexico, we're still getting charged $13 and $15. There are places that do sell it for, you know, down to at least $8 or $7 a gram on specials and so forth. But it's about time that things got a little bit cheaper. You know, it's, what is it, Uruguay that's able to sell cannabis for a dollar a gram. And I think the state of Oregon has got a glut of cannabis, and so it's getting cheaper. So I think with legalization, whether it's in Canada or here in the States, I think we're going to see that things will get cheaper and better, I think, in the long run. What are edibles like up in Canada?
Oh, potent, from my experience. So edibles are not actually legal yet in Canada. So we're looking at, you know, maybe 2019. So about a year after, you know, flower and oils become legal, then the government is saying at that point, they'll be ready to take on infused products. So
are you saying that in the medical industry, there's no can of capsules or oil that people can, that's the medicine, that's the real medicine?
Yep, there's oils, but if people wanted to, say, have an infused smoothie or, you know, a thing of cookies, they would have to take that oil and make it themselves. So prepackaged edible goods are not
useful. Okay, all right. So let's get back to the magazine a little bit. Sure. Obviously, you know, I told you in our pre-interview that I've been in the magazine business and the lottery industry for a long time, so I know how hard it is, and I know that you have a big task ahead of you. Tell me more about the magazine and about the lifestyle of it. For instance, I have a friend who's been a guest on this show many times over the years. Her name is Dr. Regina Nelson, and currently, you know, she flies all over the world and she does write books. She has a book about the endocannabinoid system, and but she's in Spain, I believe, right now, and there's some kind of a cannabis and sex conference going on there. So I noticed that you have a feature called Cannabis in My Bedroom. So tell me about that article.
Sure. So that article was written by a writer named Annie McEachran, who lives on the east coast of Canada, so in the Maritimes. And this is a really, really personal, intimate, authentic essay that Annie wrote. And she talks about how she is, you know, she practices conscious celibacy, and how cannabis really played this role in her sort of getting to know her own body and find her own comfort level around sexuality. I was really, really excited when she sent it in because it was so personal and so real. I was very, very pleased to put it in the magazine.
Well, the magazine, also give out your web address real quick in the middle here, where people can go look at the magazine and subscribe as well and buy a copy, I guess, an electronic copy as well as subscribing for the print copy. What is your web address?
It's shopherblife.com.
Shopherblife.com. Okay.
Yeah.
So check.
Shopherblife. Shop Herb Life.
Okay, great. Now, we were just talking about food, infused food, and I see there is an article in this first inaugural issue that says cannabis food trends. What are the trends?
Yeah, so what we found while we were putting this magazine together was that there were a bunch of pop-up infused dinners happening all throughout Vancouver and Toronto. So we sent a writer out to go and check it out and see what was going on. There was, in particular, there's this one series called the Rebel Chef Series, which was based out of Toronto. And so they hold like a chronic cocktail event, which includes non-alcoholic drinks. And then they would pair that with tapas and snacks. And so the writer here, Libby, had just a fantastic time. But she also talks about things like the Green Market, which is another Toronto event, and it would happen every month. And it would bring together all kinds of makers from the gray market so that consumers would have an opportunity to peruse and purchase.
So the gray market, how would you describe the gray market? Tell me.
Sure. Really, it's the black market, but because everything is so gray and fuzzy here sometimes, everybody just sort of refers to it as the gray market.
how does that How is that not being busted? How is that legal for the gray market to have an open farm?
Not. It's not at all. So these are activists and advocates who are going out of their way and risking their own freedom to make these products available.
Uh-huh. So you had told me also that you have a lot of people from the U.S. that are going to your website. Is there any, do you think there's any difference between the female user in the U.S. than Canadian females, or is it the same? Or they have the same needs and wants?
Yeah, I feel like they're all very similar in the sense that, maybe they're just kind of tired of having to hide their cannabis use or justify their cannabis use. And a lot of women just want to be out and open and comfortable with it because they know that they're not doing anything wrong and they're not harming themselves or anyone around them. And you've got this sort of, wine o'clock mommies who drink wine when they drop their kids off at school culture that's so funny and people love it. But that's actually, it's not healthy. It's not good for you. So there's a lot of women who read Herb Life who feel like, they should be able to be proud and share pictures of their plants and their buds and the edibles they make.
Absolutely. So do you have an Instagram page where people are posting, like your readers are posting pictures like that?
Yeah, absolutely. So our Instagram page is @the_herblife. And if you tag us, we always love that. We'll probably reshare most of our pictures. About 90% of our pictures there are curated. So certainly if you have something wonderful going on, tag us and let us know.
Fantastic. So let me just, I'm jumping back and forth to what's happening in Canada because I haven't done too many shows on Canada. And it seems to me like some of the big corporate industry of cannabis in Canada are really moving down here. And I know that they've bought some big companies in California and Washington. I think there's more experience going on up there in Canada. How do you feel about Big Canna, so to speak?
I'm okay with it. I'm okay with it because we have the opportunity to sort of level the playing field and allow for smaller enterprise. So for a while there, between 2014 and this past spring, it was really like the thresholds, the barriers to entry of this industry were. Ridiculous. I mean, it was very expensive. You needed huge facilities with great big vaults and, quality assurance people. But now they've created this micro license level. So you could be a micro processor or a micro lab or a micro cultivator, and your costs associated with that would be far less. So because we have options, I'm happy with it.
Right. Are they limiting, like for producers, are they limiting their plant counts, and how much can a micro licensee grow as compared to a full licensee?
Yeah, sure. So with a micro license, you are limited to a canopy span of 200 square meters, which isn't very much at all. But you can have more than one license. So there's that option.
How many licenses can you buy?
As far as I know, you can have as many as you have, properties for.
Gotcha. So I don't know if you know the answer to this, but what's the outdoor season like in, let's say, BC, because that's where you are? Is it a short season? I know that people have been growing in closets and so forth, but, for me, I like sun-grown cannabis. So what's the season like in BC? Do you have a long enough season that they can grow outdoors?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I put my plants in the ground sort of, end of May. And I mean, they're clones at this point. I don't necessarily start from seed, and I typically harvest end of September. And that's pretty standard for outdoor up here.
Yeah. Well, I'm in Santa Fe, New Mexico again, our season is like, you sort of can put them out in May, but, they might flower too soon. So we're sort of like a June 1st. I'm 7,500 feet up. So we have a very short season, but I've actually kept a sativa out through some snow till November 11th, which and I still don't think it was finished. So it really depends upon where you live in what your atmosphere is and the light, you know, the ratio to light to dark to have a longer period of time. Before we go, I see another very interesting article in here called Women to Watch. Okay, this is really your magazine is really all about women, for women. So name a couple of people that we should watch this year.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so when we were putting this together, it was really, really difficult to narrow it down to these women that we eventually landed on. But some of the ones that I would really want to highlight would be Jamie Shaw, who has been an activist in the industry for, I think, 20 years now. She does a lot of work with helping to set up dispensary regulations and working with dispensaries. And now she does a lot of government relations, so working on policy. Another person is Julie Domingo, who is, she's an educator with CannaReps, and CannaReps is a company that trains budtenders and frontline dispensary workers. Who else? There's Berinda Rasode, who is, we called her the industry influencer, and she's also in research and education.
So these people are totally involved and have been for a long time. And is this something that you, do you feature people every issue? Are you going to be doing that, or, you know, are you going to keep
well,
up?
Well, so
go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. On our website, we do something called the Spotlight Series every week, every Friday, where we highlight a different woman who's, you know, created something or is leading a company in the cannabis space. And in terms of the print publication, it will definitely be an annual thing. So I think every year, the summer issue will highlight another group of women who are going above and beyond.
Sure. And how often are you going to be publishing?
Right now, we're doing twice a year.
Twice a year. And how much? So you can buy single issues. Obviously, you only have one out now. So when will your next one come out?
The next one will be out in early January.
Oh, okay. So this, okay, so twice a year. So you're sort of starting, this is your inaugural issue, okay? So I understand getting into a routine is very hard. So how much is, if someone wanted to buy an issue, how much is one issue?
Sure. So if you wanted to buy a hard copy, it would be $10 Canadian. And if you wanted a digital download, it's $6.95 Canadian. So what is that U.S.?
I have like, no idea. Like, you tell me.
Something like $5 for a download.
I don't even know what a meter is or metric anything. You know, we're in a whole different world here. And while I say that, let me just apologize for the rest of the United States for the guy that's ruining our country right now. I apologize to Canada. I had nothing to do with it, but I'm sorry. Pass it around that I'm sorry, okay?
Well, I'll let everyone know.
All right. Thank you, Jill. I really appreciate your time today. Is there anything else you'd like to say that you forgot about?
Well, you know, the only other thing I'd like to add is that for this particular issue, we partnered with a creative agency called Bloom and Grow out of Vancouver, and they're responsible for all of the layout and the vast majority of the photographs. So I just wanted to shout them out because they're amazing.
Well, you know, I was going to mention the photographs. I thought they were very, very good. And whoever did those, you know, most of, you know, all the ones that I saw anyway, it looks like they have a really good eye. And that's really nice to see. So I want to thank you again. Give out your website address and any kind of way that people can get a hold of you if they have a question.
Sure. So website is shopherblife.com. And on Instagram, we are the_herblife. And that's probably the best way to find us.
Excellent. I really appreciate it. Jill Pollard, thank you very much. We'll have you back maybe right before the next issue comes out in January so that people can be reminded again. And check women out there, check this out. There's all kinds of products. There's people that are advertising, I guess, apparel and so forth. Someone, a friend of mine, two friends of mine just sent me a pair of cannabis socks. I want to thank Cam and Patty for that, for my birthday. I appreciate that. And I've never had any cannabis attire before, except for maybe tie-dye shirts back in the day. But Jill, thank you very much, and I look forward to having you back again. Good luck with your publication.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
We'll be right back after this.
No, none of mine. Oh, yeah, nah, 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 boy, yeah. Say none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. All of my herb trees, them just are glowing at the sunlight, breaking at the moonlight. None of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come sample me herbs, please. Tell I at night which one you like. Say in the morning it make my cup of tea. Good for me, Medi. It gives me plenty energy to try down my journey. So I'm spread sativa in the cassency. We cultivate it, so the basket it never empty. It's always there when I need it, yeah. So none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come sample me herb trees. Tell I at night which one you like. None of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So when me swap in me herb seeds, I just the female ones me like. The herbs is the healing of the nation. So come home from the police station. We need more love and communication. Liberation for the people of the nation. Them no want a moderation, cause them no home, no obligation. We use the herbs for our communion. The herbs is for our religion. So none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come and sample me herbs, please. Tell I at night which one you like. Hey, hey. None of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. When me swap in me herb seeds, I just the female ones me like. All of my herb trees, them just are glowing at the sunlight, breaking at the moonlight. None of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come sample me herbs, please. Tell I at night which one you like. Say in the morning it make my cup of tea. Good for me, Medi. It gives me plenty energy to try down my journey. So I'm spread sativa in the cassency. We cultivate it, so the basket is never empty. It's always there when I need it, yeah. So none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come sample me herb, please. Tell I at night which one you like. None of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So when me swap in me herb seeds, I just the female ones me like. Say the herb is the healing of the nation. So come home from the police station. We need more love and communication. Liberation for the people of the nation. Them no want no moderation, cause we no hope, obligation. We use the herbs for our communion. The earth is for our religion. So none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. So come and sample me herbs, please. Tell I at night which one you like. Hey, none of my herb trees never turn hermaphrodite. When they swap in me herbs.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio. Radio Show.
Well, I want to thank my guest, Gill Pollard, up there in British Vancouver, Canada. Thanks for the information. Check out the magazine when you get a chance. That's Herb, H-E-R, parentheses B. Anyway, also want to thank my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS. Thank you for your inspiration. If you have a product to sell, a story to tell, you're an activist, an advocate for cannabis, it's info@mmjradio.com. Again, info@mmjradio.com. If you'd like to hear some of our old shows, you can go to medicalmarijuanaradio.com. Also, my YouTube channel is LSLove88. On SoundCloud, we're MMJ Radio. On Spreaker, we're MMJ Radio as well. We have a channel on the Cannabis Tube, not the Cannabis Tube, it's cannabistube.net. On Spreaker and iHeartRadio, we're also on the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. On NowTV.com, channel 937, and thecannachannel.com, coming very soon. The medical, medical
marijuana. Shalabat. Shalom.
Oh, yeah, and fuck Trump.
Papu boy, it's a hush, we a dapper. A papu daily. Sapapu, papu, papu, papu.